Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Buck Woody, and it's been a while since you've been on the show, so thanks for coming back.
It's been a while. Yeah, it has. Yeah, thrilled to be here.
Awesome. Yeah, we're excited to have you on the show, and today we're going to be talking about GraphQL in SQL Database and Fabric.
Yeah.
And before we get into it, like, I'd love to understand, like, why should people care about GraphQL, and what is it, and how does it work?
Yeah, I got to say, when I first heard it, I'm like, hey, you want a database app, you throw up a database, you hook up your code, you download ODBC, you connect to the database, and you do your select statements. That's the way it's intended. But it turns out that there's a lot more data sources than just SQL Server, and people want to collect data from all of them.
Right.
It turns out that there's a whole new security mechanism for the web. It turns out that everything's an API now, and it turns out developers love things like Node.js or Python. So the way I used to work a long time ago isn't the same way you want to do it now. So there's this new abstraction you can do called a GraphQL API.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how does it work?
So let me show you this. I'm no Bob Ward here, but I'm going to show you a little bit of the mechanics of how this sort of works. So it starts out, you've got a server, right? And this is a GraphQL server that sits on top of any HTTP server that will listen to those kind of traffics. Now, inside that server, it's going to make an API, an application programming interface, available to you so you can write code against it. Okay, so far, so good. But what it does is you can have lots of different kinds of data sources. And the GraphQL server has code that knows how to talk SQL, knows how to talk NoSQL, knows how to talk to files, those kinds of things. And it makes it available over that API. Now you don't need ODBC or anything else.
Wow.
You write some code, you send across a JSON document, of course, because everything is a JSON document. It has a header with your security tokens, all those sorts of things, and what you want. The server catches that, it does the work down to the data sources and sends back another JSON document. Now, we're used to in SQL, you code something and then you get back the SQL statement data that you asked for, messages and error codes, right? Well, in this case, you're going to get all that at once inside the JSON document, and then you tear it apart and look at it. The other thing GraphQL does for you is it has a schema. So as you're abstracting this thing out, you can say that these fields look like this. That's the schema, very similar to a SQL schema, with the exception it's over all kinds of data. And you have not select statements, but you have things called queries. To change data, you have something called a mutation. And to subscribe to data as it changes, you can have something called a subscription. So that's all the chatter. Do you want to see it? You want me to show it to you?
Before we take a look, I'm a little curious, like, how hard is it for someone who's used to writing SQL, like, to catch on to this? Because it seems like kind of new stuff.
It's not that hard. And in fact, it's so not that hard that we're actually going to help you with it. So we'll actually write the code for you. Would you like to see that?
Yeah, I'd love to see it. But I'd also, you know, we've been talking about GraphQL. I think we were also going to talk about SQL Database and Fabric.
Oh,
like, how do
right.
these things go together?
Yeah, right. So when you make that server, that GraphQL server, you do have to stand it up. It's a web service.
Oh.
You do have to make that API available. You got to get an endpoint. You do have to write the code to talk to. Somebody's got to write SQL. Somebody's got to write NoSQL. Somebody's got to write Gremlin. Somebody's got to write those file APIs. So inside SQL Database and Fabric, though, we said, hey, we want people to use this because we'd like to talk to this. But why don't we write the server for you? So we've got that stood up for you. When you stand up a SQL Database and Fabric, you can click a single button and you can get that server set up for you automatically, get the endpoint, the whole bit.
Amazing. I definitely want to see
it. Now you want to see
it. Yes.
Okay, well, let's go for it. Here we go. So I've got my server here. You can see this is my SQL Database in Fabric, and I've just got my sales LT table, a database you can see here, and a product table. You can see that. I've clicked on it, and our UI is really nice. Got all kind of AI and things in there, but you can see the whole table there, right? So notice up at the top, though, there's that button. So I go down here. I look at sales LT. I've got all my tables. I click on product, I get my data back, but I've got that button, new API for GraphSQL. So I click that, I've done that before. The first thing I do is I just go get data, and I've done that, and I've grabbed my database. There it is, there's the database, there's all my tables. All right, now, I write for you those queries. Look at this, these are actually those queries that you need to write. I do that for you, so you don't have to write all that stuff. Here, let me run this. and we get back the data in JSON format for this. But there's more. Wait, there's more. I told you we could generate your code.
Oh.
Yeah, look at this. There's the Python. There's your connection strings, error handling. There's the query we put in there for you. You can also write Node.js if you're into that. And so this gives you sort of all of that at once. So again, the code we write for you are those abstractions to the tables. Mm. We've named them things. And we write not just the queries, but we write the mutations for you as well. So you can insert, delete, update, that sort of thing. But wait, there's more.
Okay.
You didn't know there was more coming.
No.
That get data button that you can see right there, I can actually go get other kinds of data. Data warehouse in Fabric. I can go get SQL endpoints in Fabric. So I can go get lakehouse type data from there. And I could combine it all into one look. Now my developer doesn't have to know SQL, doesn't have to know SQL data warehouse. They use one security model, one query model, one insert, update, and delete model, and they get all of those disparate data sources back at one time. How simple is that?
I love it. I love it especially because the generate code and how seamless that makes it for me. Because
yes.
I've done this before. You click it,
yes.
You paste it in a VS Code or wherever, and it literally
it runs.
Just works.
It runs.
It just works.
It pops
it's
you
amazing.
If you need to log in. It pops you for, hey, log in, and you follow your standard login, and there it is. Now, you can secure it even further if you want to make it an Azure web app, that sort of thing. All that works just fine.
Yeah, absolutely. So one final question for you is like, you have any tips and tricks for folks? Obviously, you know, this has been around for a while, this idea of GraphQL, but it's also probably new to a lot of people.
Yes,
so what
yes.
advice do you have?
We've got a ton of learning available for you. We happen to have written an entire tutorial that'll
Amazing.
Take you from starting with the database all the way to a full web application. This one I did in C#, as that's the language I'm the most familiar with. And also you can use these same things. So we have everything for you to learn. We'll put that in the notes.
Amazing. Awesome. Well, Buck, thanks so much for
Absolutely.
Coming on the show. To our viewers, thanks so much for tuning in. If you like this episode, leave us a comment and let us know what you think of this new capability of GraphQL support for SQL database in Fabric. We'll put links in the description for you to go learn more, try out Buck's new tutorial, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.